Spooky season is nearly upon us, so to help set the mood, here is a foreshadowing of what is to come. The history of radio astronomy in the sense of the search for extraterrestrial intelligence is a storied one. Ever since Cocconi and Morrison suggested a framework for searching for narrowband signals at the 1420 MHz hydrogen line, SETI has seen everything from false alarms created by Earth interference to enigmatic signals that take decades to even get close to a compelling explanation for. But that original idea boils down to essentially looking for an alien beacon of enormous energy, transmitting to the galaxy one simple, very loud message: we are out here waiting for you, for better or worse. In a sense, it might be a good thing that we never saw that screaming alien beacon, because when you think about it, within the concept of building such a thing lies some somewhat spooky implications. Such a beacon would require enormous amounts of energy to blast out a signal of that type at distance. It would presumably be narrowband. The more broadband your signal, the more energy you have to put into it, and the less technologically unambiguous it will be. The more broadband the signal, the more you look like nature. If you want to tell the galaxy you are there and you have technology, do it narrowband. That saves some energy, actually, a lot of it. But for a true beacon radiating a signal in all directions that could be picked up by the entire Milky Way, even narrowband will still require an enormous amount of energy input, even if you just focus on the galactic plane, exceeding the global energy production of Earth in its current state by far. And for any hope of anyone seeing it, you will need that beacon signal to be continuous or repeating. One-off transmissions will not accomplish your goal. You would need to leave the lights on for many millions of years or more if your motive is to inform the entirety of the galaxy of your existence, if that is indeed your motive. It has to be said here that if you are saying to the galaxy, we are out here, and by extension, come to the location of this signal, then that certainly sounds like an excellent trap. Such a beacon is not just a mega project, physically speaking. Imagine what the transmitter must look like, but also mega project in time. Look at the state of ancient human structures on Earth. The pyramids of Egypt are thousands of years old, and most of them, for various reasons, look their age. The beacon would need to be maintained and kept going indefinitely, which in fairness is easier to do in space, as opposed to Earth and its weathering, corrosion, and the human penchant for reusing building materials taken from abandoned places, on top of feeding the beacon that endless requirement of energy. As a result, Cocconi and Morrison's beacon should be looked for, and it is searched for, but no such thing should reasonably be expected to have surfaced, because it doesn't seem likely that most level-headed alien civilizations would put the time and effort into such a thing when there are easier alternatives available for communication. If they had, however, the implications would have, I suspect, been more terrifying than comforting, because to go through the trouble of a beacon, the best way to pare down your energy needs for it is to make it directional. Beam it only at planets you know have life, and you have a much more viable method of setting up your Trojan horse, contact signal. If Earth had received that directional signal, it would not necessarily mean that the alien civilization knows we are here, however. Our technological existence has had only just over a century to propagate. That's just 100 light years out, and double that time to expect a return signal. If there really is anyone in close proximity to Earth in the galaxy, it really is no wonder we haven't seen any signals, because the time needed to do it from anywhere but the closest exoplanet systems has not yet elapsed. In this sense, if signaling is directional and only happens when a civilization detects another one from a distance, then that is the solution to the Great Silence, right there. Smart aliens contacting other smart aliens with radio only do so when they detect each other. Otherwise, the galaxy seems quiet, because everything is so directional. Rarely are you in the way of a signal in order to intercept it. But if it's directional, how do they detect each other at all? And the answer is leakage. Accidental detection may also lead to intentional communication, and that's the only way it might happen. Though in fairness, this does not cover another possibility, that aliens beam signals at planets with known biospheres. Here, they would be aware of us. Earth has been screaming its biosignatures for much of its history. But how long do you want to keep a signal on a planet with a biosphere on the off chance a civilization might pop up on it? A billion years? How long to keep up the signal with no response? As a result, aliens doing this may only do so periodically. Send a signal, say, for 1,000 years. Wait, if you get nothing back, try again in 500,000 years. On the other hand, what might also happen is something rather strange. Say a civilization picked up an obvious technosignature and beamed out a contact signal but never got a response, even after beaming and waiting for a very long period of time. They would wonder, perhaps for a very long time, why that other civilization never responds. Is it fear, lack of interest, or something more sinister? They would be left guessing. But back to the beacon. Why would you blast out so much energy in an omnidirectional massive broadcast, lasting for millions of years, when more nuanced approaches will get the job done? The answer is chilling. Because one answer would be wasteful behavior just to say hello is something aliens probably do not do. Or else they'd waste everything and go extinct, or otherwise their signal would soon shut off. The other answers are immediately worse. They could be frantically and energetically warning the rest of the galaxy of something, some unknown threat we have no ideas out there that may affect us as well. Whether it's simply a warning to stop the development of generalized artificial intelligence, or a warning that something else lurks out there, waiting to strike, that unless you build technology to overcome it in time, for when it comes for you, you will not survive. It would be interesting indeed if such a signal could be deciphered to determine that it is a warning of that, and then all of a sudden, it falls forever silent. But such a message would actually require a way to decipher it, and SETI signals are not likely to allow for this, for the simple reason that once we get one, if ever, it will be almost impossible to decode. Take something so simple as Morse code. How many people are left today that can actually decode a Morse radio signal? Only a small fraction of the population of the Earth, complicated by whatever the base language of the message is. So you need to understand Morse and the language it's code for, and that's relatively simple. Most other forms of radio communication require far more to decode, even a voice. You have to have the right technology to pick up a radio station and turn the signal into an audible message, and it won't be in common with alien technology. In short, what you see from an alien is what appears to be a raw radio signal, or one full of gibberish you can't make sense of. And that's even before you get to trying to figure out the language. And that's what we did with the famous Arecibo signal. We beamed it out, there is a message in there, but when they were formulating it, the signal was given to a group of scientists to decode without a key, and only one of them got anywhere close to figuring it out. So why would an alien beacon just blast out gibberish, but still obviously organized and clearly technological energy? Well, another reason might be that they are saying to everyone else, we are dangerous, stay away from us. Maybe they are the monster that lurks in the deep, and for some reason, they make a point to say so. Beacons aside, the bottom line is that there is no obvious beacon signal in the Milky Way of the scale of Kokoni and Morrison's vision. The search is not complete, but a really obvious one would have surfaced by now, unless it's nowhere near the hydrogen line on the dial, which may not be all that surprising for several reasons. The hydrogen line frequency, 1420 MHz, is searched specifically because everyone in the galaxy would know of this line, because it's the frequency at which cold, neutral hydrogen emits a radio signal. Aliens may choose to put it there knowing that everyone else with science will know this area, which makes a lot more sense to broadcast at than picking a random frequency, one out of potentially billions with narrowband to broadcast at. But they may just as easily say, no, don't broadcast at 1420 because that's the frequency hydrogen interferes at. Or, of course, they don't use radio at all, instead abandoning it for other means of communication. But that seems like an awful lot of trouble to go through just to abandon a perfectly usable method nature provides. And it's hard to envision doing things like radaring asteroids better with any means beyond radio. And this brings us to the WOW signal, the original one. Recently, and it took 50 years, we finally have a compelling, solid explanation for what that was. Though it's always possible that in the scientific debate, this explanation may still get called into question. A small hydrogen cloud, which the Big Ear telescope that saw WOW was indeed picking up small hydrogen clouds in the area, that was excited by an emission from a magnetar, emitting narrowband radio at 1420, much stronger than it normally would. But hidden in the history of radio astronomy is another signal that cannot be explained with a hydrogen cloud, and in many ways this forgotten signal was weirder and at least as intriguing as WOW. And moreover, unlike WOW, which was only seen once, this signal repeated. One of the reasons this other signal is obscure is that it never got the media attention that WOW has, because it doesn't have a catchy name like WOW does. The signal is known as SHGB02+14A. Not exactly a name the media is going to latch onto, and people will remember. And it was discovered in March of 2003 by the SETI at Home project, which, as many of you will recall, was an effort to use global computing power provided by volunteers that downloaded it and ran it as a screensaver. The telescope that spotted it was Arecibo in Puerto Rico, sadly now destroyed in a structural collapse, and it was actually seen three times for a total of about 1 minute. The signal was around 1420 megahertz, the hydrogen line, and it was so puzzling that it led to the signal basically getting discounted, because it was, quite simply, too weird. I'm not entirely sure what too weird is for a SETI signal. The weirder the better, but that's how it went down. The signal was between the constellations Pisces and Aries, and the first problem with it was that it was noted that there were no stars in the area, more or less, within 1,000 light-years of Earth. All that really means is that if you do pick up a signal in an area like this, it must be very, very distant, to the point that the likelihood of picking it up drops dramatically. The inverse square law: the further you go, the weaker the signal gets. And if you did get a signal, it should be incredibly weak. But this signal was in fact incredibly weak, barely detectable. But instead of bolstering the case for it, it counterintuitively factored into it being discounted. More on that in a bit. The signal featured very rapid drift, so it slid around the dial a bit, rapidly between 8 and 37 hertz a second. This could mean one of two things. The first is that it was intentionally doing that for some purpose known only to the aliens. Maybe that's part of how they communicate. The second possibility is that it was due to Doppler shift, which means that the source was rotating 40 times faster on its axis than Earth does. That factored into discounting it as well. That would be an amazing rotation rate for a planet. But that also assumed that the source was a planet. I do not think that assumption was on solid ground, because a space station or craft may well rotate that fast if the source isn't a planet. Space exists, and you can put a transmitter in space, just like you can on the surface of a planet. But here's a weird fact about this signal. Each of the three times it was picked up, it appeared at 1420 megahertz and then drifted. That doesn't seem likely for a rotating planet, but it may be likely for a signal that turns on and drifts intentionally. And I don't think the idea of intentional drift has ever really been fleshed out. Ultimately, the weirdness of the signal led it to being deemed a poor candidate for a SETI signal. And the reasons given was that it could be an artifact of random chance, which is not compelling, because that would allow any candidate SETI signal to be dismissed as an artifact of random chance. Cosmic noise was also mentioned, but again, cosmic noise could be used to explain away every radio signal ever picked up by a radio telescope, natural or SETI candidate. And finally, a glitch in the technology was offered. But glitches should either show up often and be seen in other parts of the sky when using that instrument. And since this one was identical three times, then perhaps someone should look in the data from that instrument, it's all archived, and see if that glitch is seen elsewhere. I have found no indication that this was ever done, and so that signal was forgotten. But since WOW losing its preeminence as the best SETI candidate signal we have ever received, as now probably explained, this new signal takes its place. And unlike WOW, which looked something like Kokoni and Morrison's beacon, it just didn't repeat, this other signal looks like what you might expect if you've accidentally eavesdropped on an alien space station. or interstellar starships' communications with their home world, or another distant ship. But I leave you with an interesting tidbit on this signal. When it was announced over 20 years ago, as I mentioned, it was stated that there were no nearby stars in that region to assign the signal to. This is correct. The area really is strangely devoid of stars. But in the most approximate sense, there is a star that the signal might have originated from, and it's not far. It's a binary red dwarf system, known as G73-11 A and B, located just over 100 light years out. And there's another unrelated red dwarf about the same distance, along with a very close star, one of the 40 closest stars to the Sun also being in the field, L1159-16. It seems that this signal would deserve a new observation and a fresh look at it. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently wondering what other weird signals lie in the now enormous SETI dataset. There's been some talk of that, going back and looking at old data with a fresh eye, just to see if something in the past was simply missed by the filtering. They have to employ filtering because it's no longer possible to sit and read a computer printout and circle a signal and write wow, because of the sheer volumes of data that are collected today in SETI. No human could manually do it. But with filters come missed signals, and maybe alien signals are always hard to see. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.